Hi everyone, Mark DeJesus here. Hope you're doing well. Wanted to take some time to address the subject of panic attacks and the battleground that that brings into people's lives. Of course, I'm very passionate about helping people to address fear in its various forms. And panic attacks, is one of fear's assaults that's coming upon people. You know, Jesus said in the last days, men's hearts will fail them from fear. And the Bible talks about increasing times that seem to get dark and seem to get more challenging. But there's this light that God leads us through this whole thing where He is calling us to not fear. There is a call that He's bringing to us. But yet, I'm finding that so many Christians are battling with anxiety, panic attacks, chronic worry. We're inundated with the fear factor in so many ways. And I believe that much of the reason is because we haven't been equipped. I want to take some time and pray through these areas, but also encourage you that if you're experiencing moments of panic or if you've had panic attacks, they usually come out of two main areas. I mean, there's multiple reasons that panic attacks can come about. Usually there's a chronic anxiety that's going on, that's building, and then it kind of hits a crescendo of panic. Or people who've experienced some form of trauma, if they've not had the opportunity to process through it, find safety among safe people, and come to more resolution and come to places of being able to rid guilt, shame, rejection, and aspects of fear that would want to stick with them, then it can be very, very difficult, and these panic attacks can begin to rise up. There's a bunch of different areas we could talk about as well, too. But I really firmly believe that we as believers need to be equipped. We need to be having more discussions. We need to be having more dialogue about what it means to really overcome these fears, to first feel safe talking about it and not feel condemned and judged and all that stuff, but also finding, okay, what's going on in my heart that I can invite God in to help me process, but then also encouraging each other. And so I want to just encourage those of you to have a band of brothers or band of sisters, people that you can connect with to be able to address these subjects. I believe the church should be one of the safest places to equip people into health of the mind, health in the heart, spiritual health, health in every form, that we should be able to create the best, most powerful environments for the overcoming of these battles that we face. Of course, the enemy comes to steal, kill, and destroy and uses panic attacks. It's part of the work of a spirit of fear to keep us locked down and to keep us bound. I'm going to get into a few passages of scripture to help you as I pray, because the Bible talks about the terror by day and the arrows that fly by night. So there's often certain panic attacks that come about during the day, and then there's certain panic attacks that come in the night. The Bible talks about certain battlegrounds where people will say, oh, it's day and I wish it was night, right? You just want to go to bed. And then there's the battleground of you go to bed and you just want it to be morning because the night season is so difficult. And I think it's very, very helpful that we understand psychological tools, you access helpful therapy, that the tools that are out there that are given are very important in the process. But we also need to understand that we are at war. And many, many believers have lost sight of the war they are under, especially the thoughts and the feelings that we come under on a daily basis. If you stop and just look at it, there's a lot of discouragement, negativity, and fear crossing the wavelengths of what you're hearing and listening to. If you're able to identify your emotions and what you're feeling, you can probably discern the attacks that are coming your way. And we need to be armed up. And one of the ways that I was deeply encouraged and armed up in my own journey was through the study and understanding of Psalm 91, because I really believe Psalm 91 is a textbook manual for helping people to overcome panic attacks. If you haven't gotten a copy of my book, I encourage you, get a copy of I Will Not Fear. Get it. It's available right now. You can get it in paperback. You can get it in Kindle. You can get it in audiobook. I love audiobooks. I love utilizing them. You just go to Audible or just go into the Amazon and see the book there. You can also start off by going to markdejesus.com. You can see some videos there that I've produced in my book section on I Will Not Fear. I also have a training course that has gone live this week where you can walk with me through the 28-day process. But really, I'm wanting to move and cultivate a culture in your life, in your home and in your family, that is an I Will Not Fear culture. Now, I'm not saying that we need to deny our battlegrounds, that we need to shove them down, that we need to suppress them. No, what we need to do is find safe places to process this stuff, to talk it out, and to encourage each other that, hey, we want to move more and more into an environment where we are facing our fears rather than running from them. And Psalm 91 does a fantastic job of helping us to establish this. So I just wanted to share some of this with you, and then I want to pray, because you're going to see in the pages of Scripture here some really powerful things that God is saying. He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge, my fortress, my God, in Him will I trust. You see, the first place that becomes our new response is, what does it mean to have refuge? What does it mean to have refuge in God? And there are two aspects that are important. One is understanding the love of the Father, because that love casts out fear. People are so hard on themselves about their anxiety and their panic attack issues, they don't realize there's a love issue. There's love that's missing, and we need to connect to the love of the Father. It's why I spend so much time in the rejection mindset, talking about how rejection seeks to separate us from that love. And understanding God's love as our Father, so critical and important. But there's a second dynamic in understanding the nurture of God, which is a whole aspect of His loving nature that is critical and important. And even the language of the Scriptures talks about His nurturing ways. He talks about, surely He shall deliver you from the snare of the fowler, from the perilous pestilence. So that's all the junk that wants to come at you and all the stuff that just wants to take you out. And look at the language here. He shall cover you with His feathers. Under His wings you shall take refuge. His truth shall be your shield and buckler. If you look at that first portion there, cover you in verse 4, cover you with His feathers, under His wings. What is He speaking to? He's speaking to the power of nurture. And we live in a society that is lacking nurture. We are so on edge. We are just on this place where we're just stressed out, maxed out, go, 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 hypervigilant, fight or flight, can't sit still. And nurture calms the nerves. Nurture says, it's going to be okay. The Holy Spirit is your comforter. The Holy Spirit brings the nurture of God to say, you're going to be okay. I know what the news says, but you're going to be okay. And the message of Psalm 91 is, yes, there's crazy stuff going on, but you don't have to be afraid, because you can come under His feathers. You can come under His wings. He will nurture you as a mother nurtures her child, right? Mom says, that's okay, I'm going to fix the boo-boo, which often shows us many of our fear, anxiety issues get triggered by lack of nurture, where moms didn't know how to nurture us growing up. Maybe your mom was cold, detached. Maybe she was preoccupied and she didn't know how to connect. Dad was off. He wasn't present. And then mom was struggling in her own battles. So she either neglected you, ignored you, or just looked at you and said, get over it, and didn't know how to provide nurture. So now you're 20, 30, 40, 50 years old. You're struggling with fear issues. You're wanting to receive comfort, and there's no reference. So when Scripture's like under His wings, you're like, what does that even mean? Am I hiding under a bird? Like, what is this even talking about? It's talking about the comfort that God brings through the times where you're looking around and you're going, man, the times seem to be looking tough and rough, and this darkness that's going on. He says, you don't have to be afraid. He said, you not be afraid of the terror by night, nor of the arrow that flies by day. I believe the enemy has certain assignments in the daytime and certain assignments at night. Where's your battleground? Where do you tend to battle the most? Is it daytime and you just want to just, man, I just wish it was night and I could go to bed? Or in the night season, I've had to battle both. I mean, I had to battle night torments. Many people are having night torments. You're having fights in your sleep. There are people that are sleepwalking. You're restless. You have restless leg syndrome. You have aches and pains and things going on don't allow you to sleep. There's just a constant stirring that's going on. And many times this is a work and activity of the enemy to steal your night season. Because if you don't sleep well, your daytime hours are compromised, right? And that was one of the first areas that I began to tackle in my I Will Not Fear journey, was understanding the night season. I couldn't sleep well, so I was up late, and then in the morning I was so foggy, could barely get out of bed. I felt like every time I'd wake up, I was at war, that I was like punching and fighting Mike Tyson while I was sleeping, and wake up in the morning just feeling like I got like knocked out. And I had to learn in season and process how to begin to take back my night season. And there are also daytime things where the suddenness of fear would come, and be able to learn how do I find refuge in God, but also take my shield, the truth that's my buckler. And because there's two sides to fighting fear. There is the refuge in God's love, the perfect love that casts out fear, learning to rest in the sonship and being a daughter of that love. Then there's also the warrior, where you take your sword and fight confidently. Both go hand in hand. Both are needed. So before I get into the rest of this and pray, where do you need strengthening? Is it the warrior, where you fall into pity, I can't do this, and you need some strengthening to stand and go, no, when I've done all to stand, I'm going to stand? Or are you just so worn out and exhausted? You need to learn how to rest in His love, and you're trying to fight, and you're trying to fight, and you're trying to fight, and more healing in His love needs to take place in your life. Right? This is just so powerful here. What the psalmist is bringing out, he says, you'll not be afraid of the terror by night, nor the arrows by fly by day, nor of the pestilence that walks in darkness. Just that darkness that comes at you, the destruction that lays waste at noonday. So you see the different assignments: nighttime, daytime arrows, the darkness, and the destruction. So which comes at you? Identify that. And start to develop a strategy from here, from Psalm 91, that says, okay, now this just amazes me. And I've been sharing this with a lot of people I've been helping in personal sessions. The promise here is you're going to see a lot of crazy stuff. God is not saying, hey, this is going to get easier. There's going to be intense times that come. And people go into further panic attacks. He's like, no, that's for the wicked. It's not for you. Don't you worry. 1,000 may fall at your side. Like, that's intense. And just if you thought that was like Hollywood, like intense kind of action scene, 10,000 at your right hand. But here's the deal, ladies and gentlemen, but it shall not come near you. Only with your eyes shall you look and see the reward of the wicked. He's talking about difficult times, that you'll see it, but don't be afraid. And what we can fall into, and this is what we have to be cautious of, is that we can fall into the same patterns of fear that the world lives under. You know, when we think of being worldly, we think of, like, you know, certain sins, but we don't think about the world infecting us in how we look at fear. Fear drives media. Fear drives what people consume, what they talk about, which fuels chronic negativity, which fuels despair. So the world relies on certain things for peace. How's the bank account doing? How's my persona and how I appear? Do I appear successful? Right? Does everyone think I'm doing well? How's the bank account? And a lot of surfacey things that, when those things collapse, what do we have to rely on? God's calling believers to go deeper. Like, no, your reliance is way deeper than that. And you're going to look and you're going to see stuff. And then you're going to come into panic. No. This is the call for overcomers. And I want you to pay attention to this. God is wanting you to face your fears now and the issues of your heart that He's wanting to heal, so that when the day comes and others are collapsing in fear, you're standing tall to be a voice crying out, to give people hope, to turn to God, and to give Him their hearts. And God's setting you up as a mouthpiece. So the stuff you're working through and operating through, and you're practicing what it means to overcome. Stop beating yourself up. God didn't put this stuff on you. But you know what He's doing? He's leading you into how to learn to overcome. So I encourage, if you're an overcomer, you need to be tuned into learning, discovering, and searching out what God is saying to you. Get the help and equipping that you need, rather than just falling into despair, rather than just checking out and numbing out. That's not going to do any good. Is learn and discover, what are the tools that I need to uncover? Because I want to live in that way. Because if God says, you'll see it, but it won't come near you, but I serve the same fear that they're serving, am I setting myself up now to live under the same darkness that is actually meant for me to watch happen in other arenas, but it won't come near me? So God's like, it's going to happen, but just don't be afraid. And I know that's easier said than done, but just make that your central compass that you begin moving towards. To say, what is it going to look like to have a strong warrior heart, but also a sensitivity of sonship to receive the love and tenderness, the comfort and nurture that God would have for me? Right? This is powerful stuff here. So He says, 1,000 will come at your side, 10,000, because you have made the Lord, who is my refuge, even the Most High, your dwelling place. No evil shall befall you, nor shall any plague come near your dwelling. And check this out. You want some extra backup? He shall give His angels charge over you to keep you in all your ways. Come on, man. God is saying, if you'll just line up with an I will not fear mentality, I got backup. Because isn't that what you want to know? You want to know that somebody's got your back? That there's backup for you, that there's help for you. Listen, the Father's got your back. The Son has paid the price. He's interceding for you. The Holy Spirit is comforting you and giving groanings that cannot even be uttered. There's the saints that have gone before us, the cloud of witnesses, man, the hosts of heaven that are cheering you on. And on top of that, you got angels that are watching over you, come on, that are assigned to the call that God is doing. So what does this mean? This means you're not alone. And panic wants to use loneliness as leverage, that darkness of you're alone and no one's going to help you and you're the only one going through this. Let me tell you something. A quarter of our population has a diagnosed mental health issue. Those are just people that are getting diagnosed. That is not to mention the large percentage of people struggling, and they don't even realize what they're struggling with. They're not realizing what they're up against. Pastors, look at your congregation. Way more than half, probably three quarters to your congregation, has some kind of anxiousness, worry, constant obsessive thoughts, panic moments that they're not even know how to deal with and process, right? And God is saying that, I want to equip you in this. I want to equip you in what it means. And I'm going to give, you have no idea behind the scenes what is happening. And I want to teach you what it means to rely on my love, live in the hope that I've given you, and walk in dynamic, powerful faith. And so this, I want to close this out because I want to pray. You shall tread upon the lion and the cobra, the young lion and the serpent you shall trample underfoot, because He has set His love upon me. Therefore, I will deliver him. This is major because we have Christians that are trying to, I'm going to be strong. I'm going to be strong. I'm going to be strong. And you're just like, I think I can. I think I can. I think I can, right? Trying to build faith. Faith needs hope to be strong. All you need for faith is a faith of a mustard seed. But it needs hope to rely on. What is hope? Hope is your divine vision. It's how you see. And if your eyesight is jacked up, then fear has an opportunity to contaminate your hope and give you a panic-driven vision, right? But what does hope need? Hope stands on something. The love of God. Faith, hope, love. They stand on top of each other. The love of God is the foundation that hope builds upon. Hope does not disappoint because the love of God, that is why we need to get the love factor improved in our lives of understanding God is love. Man, you're going to walk on the lion and the cobra? Like, give me a break. This is incredible. Because what? Because you're super strong? Because your faith is like so intense? Because you're so full of wisdom? No, because His love is on you. That's why I work so intensely in reminding people of their need for love to be perfected in their lives. He shall call upon me, I will answer. So if you need the love of God, call upon it, and He will answer. Rejection will say, nope, He's not answering you. Nope, nothing. He's not here. He's gone. He's abandoned you. He's left you hanging. He's not there. Fear and rejection work hand in hand to say, you know what? You're all alone. Nothing's ever going to change. Nothing's ever going to be better. Nope. He says, I'll be with you in trouble. I will deliver you, honor Him with long life. I will satisfy Him and show Him my salvation. So, Father, I just pray for those who've been under chronic anxiety and worry, those who have experienced traumas and dramas and have stuff that they've gone through and they don't know how to process. They don't even know what to do with the stuff they're facing. And now it's building to aspects of panic, aspects where it just kind of grips their chest or it grips their neck or just across their shoulders, or there's this weight in the mind, this darkness that just clouds over them. Father, I pray for a breakthrough moment that I first invite your love as a father, your comfort. Holy Spirit, I pray for the comfort and nurture to begin to invade their hearts. We thank you for that love. And right now, we just want to break agreement with panic. We want to break all agreements with panic attacks. That word panic that comes from the word pan, which they would use in Greek mythology as a fearful demonic force. God, I just break all agreements right now. You've not given us a spirit of fear, but power, love, and a sound mind. So we just say no to that right now. And we say yes to your love. We say yes to hope. We say yes to faith. So I just pray right now for the body to begin to calm down, for heart rate, palpitations, a intensified breathing. We just call the breathing to calm down right now in the name of Jesus. We repent, we renounce of all agreements with panic. Any panic disorders, any targeted fear that comes at certain triggered moments. I call for healing of that right now, for a reset. Reset right now. Reset the nervous system. Reset the endocrine system. Reset hormones. We ask that the body come into peace right now in the name of Jesus. We take authority and bring the cross of Christ against the work of panic attacks. We command your works to leave now in the name of Jesus. You're not welcome. You're not welcome in people's lives. We thank you, Jesus, that you paid a price where we could sleep in a boat in the midst of a storm. Not sleep and live in denial, but have a peace and know when to stand up and speak to the storms rather than being taken out by them. I thank you that we can dwell near you, that you are not afar off. You're right here. I pray for a releasing of rejection mindset that makes people feel separated from your love, separated from your loving presence. And I pray for a deep working in their body right now, for homeostasis, for peace, for a calming of their hearts and minds. So we bring Philippians 4 into effect right now. to be anxious for nothing, to be concerned or careful about nothing, to even, that word even talks about taking no thought. But by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, so we thank you and we bring our needs to you, we cast the cares on you, and the peace of God, which surpasses, bypasses, breaks through human reasoning. It's just peace. I know storms here. I know this is going on, but I'm at peace. I pray, Father, you give us a lens of your love and your peace so we can look at the mountains, look at the obstacles with an overcoming heart, and reset our focus on the love that you have for us. Thank you for that love that you've shown. And so I thank you for peace. I pray for peace to continue in the nervous system of people's lives. Peace come to the mind. I ask for a reset, Father, just a reset opportunity. Stillness coming over their skin, over their nervous cells, over their stomach, respiratory, reproductive organs, digestion, muscular tissue relax, the cramping would stop, inflammation in the joints would calm down, headaches, eye strain, pain in the jaw, be healed right now. That God would just rest his love upon you. That you'd sense it, you'd connect to it, that you'd feel it. My prayer for you is that you'd be immersed in the love that God has for you. And that you'd also learn to rise up and overcome, to take your peace back, to take what's rightfully yours in God. The price that was paid for you, that's yours. So I thank you, God, for this. I pray for just an encouragement of everything that's said and done here for the benefit of those you've called to this broadcast. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. God bless you guys. I love you. And get your copy today of I Will Not Fear. Get into the training course. It's available online. It's a great pricing right now for a limited time. And I just want to continue to raise up an army of believers that are willing to say, I will not fear. God bless.